some workhorse dabs.
Welcome back, friendly targets. Grab your beverage of choice, because today's combat log is going to be a long one, since I haven't punched out videos in a few weeks. I owe you guys some extended content. Anyways, our main topic of choice, which will get bounced on throughout the video, is not getting demoralized. The opening sequence of this video was essentially all of my losses over the past 3 weeks. And been on a rather severe losing streak, and this happens from time to time, now usually with me. When I'm on a losing streak, I take a break from the game. 1, 2, sometimes more, months. Well, with the channel, I don't want to do that. So we're going to talk about ways to reinsert your enjoyment of EVE Online, because nobody needs me to tell you this, but just to kind of bring it back into the spotlight, EVE Online, in my opinion, is the most brutal MMO in the world. I'll even go as far as to say it's the most brutal game I know of. See, EVE Online punishes you severely for losing, as also rewards you greatly for winning. Unfortunately, the punishment always feels more severe than the reward. So we're going to talk about interesting ways you can avoid taking an EVE break when you really don't want to take an EVE break.
Shit, he's out tracking himself. Just control space, lol. Yes, tracking is a thing. Yes, we know. He's suffering. He's gonna start neutering out the point now. Okay then, I'm giving her all she's got, Captain. All she's got? No, the signature of my ship is just too small.
So I've touched on following streamers in several videos in the past, how they can bring you great content, take a lot of pressure off your shoulders, and allow you to fly ships that you might not normally fly in certain areas because they make fantastic scouts. Now, I do not condone sniping combat streamers. They're bringing you great content, and if you kill him, well, then there goes your content for, like, the next 10 minutes. Anyways, I do, however, fully support sniping anybody who's streaming missions or a mining fleet, because if you're not a tutorial how-to channel showing people how to do things, and you're streaming a mining fleet, you need to be sniped. That's just a waste of bandwidth on Twitch. So, if you couldn't already tell, I'm following Jebby, and I'm in a tornado. You know, Jebby and this friendly tormentor ran across this raven. I think the raven took gate guns to shoot the tornado. So we have two frigates, gate guns, and a tornado to try and kill a raven with an incredible tank in the mids. Now, the raven shouldn't have died. The raven, I think, mismanaged his tank. That's why he died. You're about to see a double KO. The raven and my tornado are going to die at the same time. And although you might not consider losing a tornado anti-demoralization, because that's a thing now, I certainly do when you kill a raven. So, if you're on a losing streak, find yourself some streamers, follow them around, enjoy the content, comical moments will ensue. I don't know if they'll be
able to hold them tackle. Because I'm the only scram on grid, it looks like that cane thing. Okay, they got him! Shit!
Warp drive active.
MJD, this, you piece of shit!
Almost. Dig out. Fuck yeah. Okay, let's see that. The Raven and the Nado. Yeah. Good shit. Good shit. Oh, dude, he took 20,000 damage. That's good for a Nado. That's really good for a Nado.
And a fun fact, as you do not need a dual monitor setup to watch streamers and play Eve at the same time. You can see my single monitor setup here running the stream at 720p, small box in the middle of the screen, still allowing me to see the important information for Eve as my overview and local box. And 720p resolution is just enough to allow me to see their location and what gates they're warping to, so on and so forth.
All right, punch the gate, punch the gate. TD's tracking speed on the rupture. I guess we kill the drones first.
Define irony at its best. While in a full tank rupture, so I can make a video on why full tank cruisers are a bad idea, in my opinion, I run into probably the only situation where a full tank cruiser is a good idea. Now, second topic. Stream sniping. I'll leave this one to be answered in the comments to see what you guys think. Is it stream sniping if you're in a location and the stream you're watching comes to you? Now, I wasn't custom fit to kill a bunch of frigates, but when I saw that they were coming to shoot me, I was more than happy to stick around. Definitely gives me an unfair advantage. You guys can decide. Anyways, the Amar streamers were doing a magnate fleet. Combat magnate fleet. And this is interesting for another reason. It's a great way to prevent demoralization. These silly little fleets you can make with your friends are a lot of fun. They're cheap and comical. And although they did not manage to kill me, I got 10 magnate kill marks on my rupture, they did, however, manage to kill some expensive stuff. They killed a friendly Scythe fleet issue. That was interesting. And then some other stuff. Here's an interesting one for you guys.
I loved and I loved. secrets. I don't want them to know the way I love you. I don't think they understand.
Now we'll talk about something I like to call sidelining. This would encompass a wide variety of tactics, both combat and non-combat oriented, but essentially you're taking ships into combat areas, but you're not trying to be the center of attention. Essentially, you don't want to be the target. For this instance, I'm in a polarized stabber, not a ship I consider to be a serious combat vessel, but the overwhelming surprise DPS can often get you kills that you would not normally get. This would also shine on things for like taking cheap Tech 1 frigates and salvaging abandoned battlefields. Even Johnny Pugh would dedicate entire streams on salvaging and looting, scanning down abandoned expensive drones. So you're in combat areas that allows you to make a good profit without being the center of attention and immediately dying. Also a good way to go in whore on kill mails. You can stop at belts in the systems along the way, kill a rat to help gain your security status back. That'll also bring in the fishing tactics, whereas when people see ships at belts these days, they don't necessarily expect them to be bait, whereas nobody really baits at belts anymore. They usually do it in faction warfare complexes. Now that Proteus was worth about a billion isk on Z-Kill, is a shiny Tech 3 cruiser wreck on the Amamaki gate waiting for some lucky guy to come by and salvage to make a potential profit. So sidelining can be a very stress-free way to make a potential profit and gather valuable information. Following the sidelining tactic, I was in a nano rail Thorax, and not trying to be the center of attention because it's not a very strong ship. It's in a system there was a fight going on, so I went to one of the citadels just in hopes that an easy target would show up. And lo and behold, a stealth bomber warped to that same citadel with aggression. The aggression prevented him from tethering, allowing me to lock on to him and pretty much kill him instantly. Though, unfortunately, I wasn't fully aware of the mechanics that tethering and citadels have. Turns out this was his citadel, and he docked, and then I died. I'd never been shot by a citadel before, so this was a valuable learning experience. Just make sure if you're going to use this tactic, as soon as you kill your target, you leave, in case it's theirs. Because bad things can happen.
I thought it was the Minotaur ships that looked the ugliest.
No, yeah, Jesus, what's wrong with you? Give me, just give me something so I can throw it at you.
Okay, I said that wrong.
You have to remember, he likes to fly Minotaur.
And after boosting the confidence of some of your high-sec friends with a few stress-free missions, it's easy enough to convince them to fit up some cheap ships and go on low-sec for some PvP. You just tell them to get an empty head and fit up some cheap ships. Hell, you can buy them for them if you need to. And this will allow you to get some interesting encounters, whereas if you're a solo pilot and then all of a sudden you show up with some people that nobody recognizes, they often won't expect them to be flying with you, allowing you to get some kills that you wouldn't normally get otherwise. Like the following. Being not affiliated with this high-sec corp, it was easy enough to have them post up on the other side of the gate and make it look like I was solo, allowing me to go JCC on a brawling Cinnable at zero on a gate. Normally, not something I would do. But then you can have them jump in, and they will feel like PvP gods as they destroy a ship many times more expensive than them.
Okay, I'm on him. Orbiting and firing, and he's locked in place.
You might as well go ahead and overheat your guns. Just keep an eye on the heat. Make sure you don't burn him out. As soon as he dies, Ramon, you need to warp off, okay?
Yeah, I have him warp scrambled. Should I warp off too?
No.
Okay, he's gotten into my armor, gotten into my hull.
Oh, that's the gate gun.
He's done.
Ah.
Oh, the gate gun's got me?
Yeah, see, we went GCC for this guy.
They I'm switched. Being shot at.
It's fine, Aramis. Just start repping. All right, Aramis, warp off. Warp off. Warp off.
Warping off.
Warping off.
I'm going to get this loot and make sure your brother gets it. What the heck? What was he fit with? I don't know. We'll find out in a minute. Go ahead and get into a safe spot, Aramis. Wherever you can, that's safe.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm without a ship, so...
it's okay. This loot's going to pay for your ship.
Oh, all right.
Fireworks are always fun. Just in case you've never fit a full tank combat ship with festival launchers and taken in a low sec and just had an absolute enjoyable time shooting people with fireworks while they peck away at your tank, you should try it. It's quite enjoyable. And if you ensure, you pretty much lose nothing except the fireworks.
Let's get him locked up, boys! Let's get him, boys!
As entertaining as the judge is to watch when he's doing things right, he's just about as comical to watch when he's doing things wrong. A MOA versus this specific stabber fit is a good fight for the stabber, which should win every time. However, there's a limit to how many mistakes you can make and still win. The judge managed to amplify this fact even more so. During this fight, he didn't launch his drones, which means he's missing about 100 DPS. Given the fact that the stabber is rather lacking on DPS even after the buff, this is important. He's orbiting. Orbiting in a stabber in almost every situation is a bad idea. You want to keep at range or double-click in space if they try to orbit you. If it's a control MOA, then you would want to keep at range 4,000 meters and overheat the newts, which he's not doing. If it's not a control MOA, you would want to keep at range 7,000 meters and overheat the guns, which he's not doing either. He didn't overheat anything on his high slots until it was way too late in the fight. And he's permanently overheat his scram right until now. So, these are all interesting things to keep in mind. Lessons have been learned here, boys and girls, except for the judge, which I don't think we'll ever learn. But in his credit, he did use the right ammo type this time. Hooray. As much as gifts are greatly appreciated to this channel, and thank you very much for this Munin gift, I'm going to have to turn down ship contracts from now on. At least ships that I don't fly. Especially expensive ones. See, the Munin, gifted to me from this awesome player, is a very bad solo ship, in my opinion. I can't think of any good fits for the Munin. I'm sure that there's somebody out there who can do it, but there's a reason you don't see this ship out by itself, and I've never had it on the channel. Now, in his honor, I did attempt to fly this ship several times with a few different fits. None of them worked. I tried the armor brawling one, but without the web, it wasn't very good. I tried a buffer one, but without the cap booster, it wasn't very good. And then I tried a kiting one, which died in a terrible ball of fire. and just ended up costing well more than was worth in time and ISK. So, just an FYI, guys, I will not be accepting ship contracts anymore. I mean, stabbers are always welcome to the channel, but I just can't make these weird ships work. So, for solo pilots who have ever had to deal with a drive-by interceptor, you know just how infuriating that can be, let alone two of them, and three can induce a level of madness not measurable by modern technology. See, a drive-by interceptor is essentially an interceptor with a long point and a scram, who'll bounce in and out of scram range to shut off your micro-warp drive, allowing his fleet to catch up to you. But they underestimate the stabber's high mobility. See, interceptors are almost always cap-stable, running their point and micro-warp drive. However, when they try to run 2 points and they get hit with two small newts and a scram themselves, they become almost dead in the water. There are three of them here, two of them die, one of them decides he's done and had enough. And the good thing about killing these drive-by interceptors is they generally feel so immune that they'll tend to fit expensive points and sometimes expensive shield extenders. So if you actually manage to kill one and scoop its loot before the fleet gets on top of you, you can get a good payout. So the Stabber So Fast version with the two overdrive injectors is really good at combating these drive-by scrams. So in this encounter, I'm in the Stabber So Fast, and I'm up against 5 small ships, a destroyer, a couple of frigates. Ideally, I'd rather be in the extra-large Invol version with the afterburner to fight a handful of frigates. However, being in the micro-warp drive version can work just fine, so long as you can spread them out just a little bit. And this isn't a spread out while kiting tactic, this is just so you can get them to come in one by one, the slowest ships in the back, which are usually the heaviest DPS or the heaviest tank. With the two overdrive injectors, even while you're scrammed, you're still plenty fast, as long as you're not super webbed down to oblivion. That's why I try and split them out. Now, I tried to play this as cool as I could. If I burned all the way out to 100 kilometers, there's a good chance after they came in, they would have just left because they assumed that they wouldn't catch me. But if I was too close, they would have probably killed me due to dogpiling onto me. About 60 to 70 kilometers seemed to be a sweet spot. So you're still engageable. People might still try and burn out to you. Yeah, we'll hold the mic a little closer to give you guys that super chill voice, and should sound a little better in the video. Yeah. Okay, so the rest of these combat logs are going to be pretty random and in no in particular order, as I have so many of them that I was getting a headache trying to put them in order. Sorry, multiple computers play EVE Online, stuff happens. Anyways, they're mostly just for entertainment, but if you happen to find them informative, good for you. The Dal solar system lately has been really hot. I don't know why, I don't know what its strategic advantage is, but it's been full of war targets, mercenaries, and friendlies. And the interesting thing is, according to the mercenaries, they're hired by the Amar because the Amar can't fight their own battles. That's pretty funny when the mercenaries talk trash about their own employer. Anyways, the mercenaries are fun targets because when you kill one, it's like the best feeling in the world. You turn a solid green killboard red for a short time. They have a general tactic while flying in these large compounds where they will stay in between you and the warp out. So if they want to leave, it's easy, and if you want to leave, you have to burn into them. Well, I figure a nano tempest with a micro jump drive and a micro warp drive shouldn't have a problem countering this method. Now all of a sudden, I'm in between him and his warp out, and he has nowhere to go. And projection on autocannons is always a wonderful thing. Goodbye. So a few videos ago, I touched on how having an afterburner can give you a strong advantage in a brawling situation when you're fighting a ship with a micro-warp drive, as my stabber has proved many, many times. But how most cruiser pilots generally won't tend to fit an afterburner opting for a micro-warp drive because, well, of situations like this. They're susceptible to being kited to death, either by small ships with a little bit of DPS slowly eating away at them, or in my situation, a small ship with no DPS waiting for his big friends to show up and obliterate me. This was followed up by a few small ships, and eventually a phantasm was on his way because, holy crap, they don't have balls. Whatever. Anyways, the nice thing about cruiser hulls is you generally have plenty of cargo hold to fit a mobile depot with extra mods, a full complementary of ammunition to last you for hours, and about 12 Navy 800 cap boosters, so there's really no excuse not to bring a mobile depot. And top it all off, mobile depots are cheap, and they have enough hit points to outlast damage from small ships. So say a Garmer catches you and is holding you down. If you drop a mobile depot and he tries to shoot the mobile depot, chances are you're going to be able to use it before he can reinforce it. I tried similar tactics with a micro jump drive, but unfortunately the mobile micro jump drive has so little EHP that even a Garmer can kill it before you can activate it. So once again, we're in the Stabber So Fast, fighting drive-by scepters. The nice thing about this is, as long as you can kill just one of them, it's already paid for your ship. So in this situation, you're going to see me kill two of them and then lose the Stabber. I'll take that any day, especially considering the fact that the first one, when he was still cocky, had a nice shiny fit with a faction point and a faction shield extender. Learned his lesson on the second one, which didn't have anything near that shiny. So dealing with one of them is really stress-free. Now, dealing with multiples can give you a headache, but just one in the Stabber, easy to deal with, because you essentially you just overheat your newts, you overheat your scram, and you just keep spamming that scram and the newts, so as soon as they come in to dry, they get that drive-by, you've zapped some cap, and you've slowed them down. Now, they slowed you down, but see, it's going to take a few moments for your momentum to stop. And usually by the time you start to slow down, they've either stopped and you've killed them, or they burned out of scram range and you just overheat your micro warp drive and punch it again, forcing them to come in constantly, get this drive-by scram. Well, see, normally this wouldn't be a problem for them against other ships, but doing it against the Stabber when the Stabber can heat to 5,000 meters a second means that after two or three at best, they're dead. So farming militia members, they can be really annoying, especially whenever you're trying to go in and get a fight. But the worst are the ones who will literally come into your plex and stick around as long as there's no combat. But as soon as a fight breaks out, they warp off. And you're going to see this several times. The worst are the ones who literally watch you fighting someone and let you die. And then they warp off. Well, this little Atron came into my compound when there were many other compounds he could have gone into, making it less profitable for both of us. He was non-combat fit, he had no guns, and his kill board showed that he was non-combat fit. I asked him to leave. He didn't leave. I locked him up and launched drones. He didn't leave. I gave him one more minute. He didn't leave. And then Stabber So Fast 5,000 meters a second killed Atron because Stabber don't care. If you're going to be a farmer, don't go into a plex with a Stabber. Because I have no problem AWOXing assholes. My promotion status is so well kept because I run so many of these damn sites. So I completely understand that you can't have the right ship and fit for every situation. I'm just going to tell you the fit that would have worked in his situation to kill my Stabber. First off, I don't like ships that ignore their bonuses. In this situation, him not using a tracking disruptor means that the only thing his ship has is a damage bonus to drones, and it's not a very strong one. The Arbitrator's DPS is pretty anemic. The Arbitrator, in my opinion, is one of the few brawling cruisers for solo PvP that can benefit from a buffer tank instead of an active tank because of the tracking disruptor, essentially allowing you to negate a good portion of the enemy's DPS. And if they try to kite you, well, then you can force them to come in close. Plus, a buffer fit on an Arbitrator means that you can definitely fit a mobile depot with extra modules, meaning that if something does try to kite you to death, you just get out of dodge with some warp core stabs. Now, in this situation, had he had Afterburner Scram Web Tracking Disruptor, he would have still been able to fit a 1600 mil plate, a Tech 2 medium energy neutralizer, and a full rack of light missiles, possibly even rapid lights, depending on his rig slots. The Arbitrator is pretty good on power grid, it's pretty good on capacitor, meaning he's going to be able to run that newt for quite some time. Just my opinion, and I think that brawling fit would work well against other cruisers. This is a fight worthy of a montage, but you're going to get commentary over it instead. This is against First Commander, a pilot who has killed me many times, but never alone. See, this is a good pilot. I'm not saying he's bad. I'm sure he's good at solo, but I never catch him solo. When I eventually do find him with only one friend, it's like a gift from the gods. I'm not going to count the Tristan against him because it's really just a Tristan. A little bit of extra drone DPS is not going to hurt me in this fit. I'm going to show you how I play this. Keep at range. I do not orbit. I see that he's not trying to orbit me, so there's no point for me to try to orbit him. I'm not going to be able to outrun those drones with a web on me, so it makes no sense. I need to apply maximum damage. And he has a micro-warp drive, which is really good for me, because it means even if he wanted to try and orbit me, he couldn't. He's too slow. It also gimps his capacitor bay, and because he's a full tank cruiser, and you guys know how I feel about full tank cruisers, he's gonna die. The reason why is he's using an active armor hardener with 2 reps while being neutered by me. This puts him under severe cap pressure, meaning that every time he caps out, his active armor hardener shuts off. And when they shut off, in case you guys didn't know that, it resets the resistance, putting him back to 15 across the board, meaning it has to cycle several times to get back to its main explosive resistance, which is what he needs right now. I'm using hail, and I overheat it as much as possible for the majority of that fight, so I get maximum damage before his active armor could really take hold. And that's it. See how many boosters I had at the end of that fight? Are you guys still flying full tank cruisers? Maybe if he had Asclepians. For all I know, he might have, but he was under severe cap pressure just from 2 small newts. The keep-it range was 4,000 meters, ensuring that the optimal range of my neutralizers was just on the edge. Let's talk about the positive security status advantage, or neutral at the very least, allowing you to find fights, and allowing fights to come to you that you would not normally get otherwise. Undocking from a market hub with a positive security status in a battle cruiser can sometimes give you this rare duel request. As you can see, I wasn't even set up to fight him yet, I was still moving my modules around. This is an Augur Navy issue trying to fight my Hurricane. But little did he know, my Hurricane is a fit that he could have not possibly expected. After a long losing streak, I decided to try something outside the box, just for fun, even if it didn't work. Well, here's the thing. Although most outside the box fits will die in a ball of fire, some of them will give you a comical kill due to the surprise ratio. In this instance, I'm a triple medium newt Hurricane with a structure tank, giving me 2 main advantages. Triple medium newts with only 4 guns doesn't give you incredible DPS, but you're still just as much DPS as a Rupture, so you're going to pump out about 500, maybe 550. Also, having the structure tank means that during the majority of the fight, your enemy is going to think that they're winning, because not a lot of people expect a structure tank on a Hurricane. And before you go out and try and do it, just know that it's nowhere near as strong as a Brutix. The unexpected aspect is probably its strongest part, and it's not a weak tank, but I don't know, it's just not incredible. Anyways, normally I would not accept a duel request in a market hub, but during my late time zone, I know that if he does have remote rep logi, it's probably going to be just 1, maybe 2, and with the 3 medium newts, I can newt him out and leave if things go south. So, easy way to prevent demoralization, try really weird fits. Now, normally when I see a Garmer on D-scan, I just take off. But because I use Z-Kill to research my targets first, when I have time, I decided to stick around because this individual's loss mail show that he had lost a few brawling Garmers, the Rocket Garmer. And I completely respect that fit, because it's kind of suicidal. And going up against a Stabber in any brawling frigate is pure suicide. Even a poorly fit Stabber, as long as it has newts, can kill a frigate. In this situation, and don't expect it to happen all the time, I decided that after I could secure the kill, I was just going to let this guy go. See, knowing I could kill a Garmer is good enough for me. And because I don't want him to get so demoralized that he goes back to running kiting Garmers, I figured we'll let him keep this one. Well guys, I hope you enjoyed this kind of feature-length style commentary video. Let me know in the comments if you think it was too long and just right, or if you'd like them to be even longer. And I'm going to leave you with the epic fight footage montage style, and then of course we got to fly a drone. Also, I want to let you guys know I'm probably going to be taking a little break from making videos for, I don't know, maybe a month. As I got some real-world stuff to deal with. Nothing bad or anything, it's just that time of year. So I will see you guys in the next video. Thanks for watching. I can hear the lost crying. I can hear the truth hiding. Yeah, the shadows are calling us out. I see the fear rising. Yeah, but
the shit.